organization. We got about 40 people to show up to two lectures, and that's with one week of organization, that's it. Last month in California, I had 300 people, and I give a very different, infinitely more formal lecture. I'm going to be very informal tonight. I'm going to bop around from one point to another, just for the heck of it. It's just like a living room gathering. Okay, now, Sabbatai Zevi should be known to every Jew. He really should be in Jewish history something unique and huge, because more than half the Jews of the world thought he was the Messiah. And they did incredibly stupid things in the days of redemption. This was in the 1660s, when he declared that he was the Messiah of the Jews, and he ordered the Jews to blaspheme the Torah. That's putting it mildly. What he decided was that debauchery was theology. That every word of the Torah is true in the opposite sense. That means 613 mitzvot were all sins. And all the sins became mitzvot. And, well, let's take a simple example. Do not kill became do kill. Do not adulter became do adulter. Purim was his favorite holiday. That was the annual wife swappers holiday. It was called extinguishing the lights. And by his order, the Jews swapped wives. All over the world, this was not a local phenomenon. Now, all the books say the same thing, that Sabbatai Zevi gained prominence from Iran to Mexico. All over the world, the Messiah was going to come, and he announced the date. And this date, by the way, is significant because it shows he had Christian backers, theologians behind him. He declared he was the Messiah on June 18th of 1666. June, of course, is the sixth month. 18 is 6 times 3, and we don't have to... 666 is obvious enough. And on that day, all of a sudden, it was the time of redemption. And the Jews could do anything they wanted. You know his prayer, the prayer that the Jews quoted, were blessed be he who permits the forbidden. That was the actual Sabbatean prayer. And the Jews went through an orgy worldwide of, again, the Christians were called Satanism, but it was certainly he changed Judaism in the worst possible way. Now, I'm not sure if you understand that Sabbatai Zevi did not die. Now, this is the real issue and the real problem, is that the Sultan of Turkey said enough of Sabbatai Zevi. This was in September of 1666. All over the world, they were coming to his court, and Turkey suddenly, by the way, Gaza was the home of Sabbatai Zevi, and his chief theologian, his PR flack, was Nathan of Gaza. Nathan of Gaza. Now, I wrote a book called Bye Bye Gaza, where I'm telling you folks the evacuation of Gaza and the atrocity done to the Jews there is traceable back to Sabbatai Zevi, and the Jews don't recognize what's going on in Israel, and we're going to get to that, because this Sabbatai Zevi absolutely led to the Holocaust directly. And these facts, go and look up Sabbatai Zevi in a book of Jewish history. Where did he go? He was the most influential rabbi, in modern times, and he has been rubbed out of the history books. Keep that in mind. You can't find that much in Sabbatai Zevi. But the Sultan of Turkey said, enough, you have to convert to Islam. And Sabbatai Zevi, now there are conflicting reports, but he apparently, without any resistance, took off his kippah and put on a turban, and the next thing you know, he was a Muslim. And most Jews worldwide abandoned Sabbatai Zevi, and they were very, very upset. You know, you have to realize what they did leading up to the day that he announced he was the Messiah. They stripped their houses of roofs because they thought they were going to be transported magically to Jerusalem. They buried themselves up to their necks in, this was, you know, in Europe leading up to June, it's awfully cold to be buried in the ground, getting punishment. They would flagellate, they would throw themselves into the Mediterranean, the icy waters. The Jews went nuts. Worldwide, they went nuts. And that's what's happening to Israel today. Israel is going nuts. And I'm trying to explain where it's coming from. And the Israelis just think, darn, we got the worst leaders anywhere. They just lie. They don't stop lying. You can't trust them. Israel is going nuts. And you're going to see slowly how this came to be. Call it an alternative retelling of Jewish history, because it really is. When Sabbatai Zvi converted to Islam, most Jews abandoned, but not all. There was a sect in Turkey called the Donna who decided that this was, in fact, a magical pronouncement by Sabbatai Zvi that we should all convert to other religions, but secretly practice Sabbataism. And the Dharma kept Sabbatai Zvi not just slightly alive. Last night, the rabbi gave me a book. I hadn't read it before. It's a great book. Rabbi Gittleman? What's the rabbi's name?
Lyndon Black.
Say it again?
Lyndon Black.
Lyndon Black, a very smart rabbi. I want you to know. Very bright man. He gave me a book to read, which confirmed everything. It's not like it was a shocking pronouncement. But it goes into the Dharma and the effect they had on the Hasidic movement during the 17th century was profound, profound. You know, the a new fact I didn't know, I got yesterday, that Rabbi Yehuda HaHasid, or a Churban, a Beit Knesset was built to him in the old city of Jerusalem that ran until 1948 when the Jordanians smashed it. It was rebuilt after 67. This guy was a Sabbatean. And this book explains that all this. He went to Turkey and he met other Sabbateans and he became a radical Sabbatean. This stuff was very, very under the ground but real. And it infiltrated the Hasidic movement. Most Hasidic rabbis didn't like it, but there were plenty who did. Okay, now what we've got is a movement now that is now a true blue, use the word conspiracy because that's what it is. They're hiding, they may be, well, originally Muslim. That changed very quickly 50 years later when Jacob Frank was born in Poland and converted his Jews to Catholicism. But originally it was Muslim. You know, I was at a conference in New York and a Turkish lady came up to me and thanked me for all the things the wonderful Turkish Jews have been doing to make their country so prosperous. And I said, what are you talking about? There's 50,000 Jews in Turkey. She said, there's millions. She said, our whole ruling class are Jews. I said, no, they're not. She says, they are so. They've been Jews ever since the days of Sabbatai Zvi. I said, oh, God, is it that serious? Is that serious? And Turkey is run by the Sabbateans, and we'll get to that shortly. But what can I say? Jacob Frank. Jacob Frank was Europe's second Messiah. That's what he was called. The second Messiah of the Jew was Jacob Frank. And he worked from about 1750, died in 1791, born in 1726. Yeah, those are about the right dates. What he did was he convinced the bishop of his diocese that his people were not Jews, they were anti-Talmudists. And the bishop bought it. And he ordered all the Talmuds of the dice burnt. And then he said, I'll bring you lots and lots of new Catholics. He brought them 5,000 to be mass converted to Catholicism. I believe the year was 1759. All of a sudden, Europe's Jews, by the many thousands, were becoming Catholic publicly. They despised Catholicism, but privately, they were Sabbatean. And as fantastic as it seems, there really, really are conspiracies of silence. If the rules are you don't open your mouth, you don't open your mouth, they exist. The Sabbateans didn't just exist as a tiny little cult. They were being converted by the thousands in the 18th century. Ron, can you please get me some water or something? This is, no, it's got to be that way.
No, there's a cup.
That
was a Sprite.
Fine, perfect. My favorite, warm Sprite. All right, now we go back. No, it's all right. I can open the Sprite, everything's fine. Now we go back to Poland, where Jacob Frank turns his followers into a nest of spies. They needed money. You know, it was hard to earn a buck. And now he had Catholics, and he had Muslims too. He had them from the Don. And he was causing sedition in the royal courts of Europe by sending these so-called Catholics to upset, to gather information and use it against the royal families. Remember, you don't have to upset a whole nation. In those days, and today too, you have to get into the inner court and cause trouble. And that's what Frank was doing. And apparently he was pretty good at it, but he went broke. And this is, oh, by the way, just to let you know about Jacob Frank and what it was to be a Jew, it wasn't all just clandestine cells and subterfuge. You got so much fun. The purification of the soul was sex orgies. Frank expanded Sabbatai Zevi. Now it's history, he's a big boy. What am I gonna say, I can't. The purification of the soul was very anti-Jewish. It was a very bad thing. There, to qualify this, he expanded Sabbatai Zvi into really a cult. And it was no different than a cult today where you control the minds of people through sex. Just leave it at that. Okay, last word I say on it. Now, something happened. Oh, and by the way, I want to add something before I forget it. This is like an off-the-cuff lecture. The first Zionists, last word on wife swapping that stuff, last word. The first Zionists and their people seeing that's all it was. Without going into the depths of who Golda Meir was and what her early life was and this and that, that's what the first Zionists were. They were Sabbatean, I'm leading to that. They actually were Sabbatean. And they participated in this stuff. They used the word secular. That's the word they used. They were seculars. This is beyond secular. Secular to me is not being affiliated with any religious group. This is beyond that, but they were called secular. Chiloni in Hebrew from the Greek Hellenistic is what they called themselves, and they were proud of it. And their goal was to turn Israelis into chilonim. They hated the religious. Let me not kid you how much the labor Zionists hated the religious. But let's go into our little story how it got that way. And it gets even spookier. Now, I want you to know that my sources were real good. I have a book there, Sabbatai Zevi, Labor Zionism in the Holocaust. Amongst my sources were Rabbi Marvin Antleman. He wrote to eliminate the opiate. He's a good friend of mine. He's pushing 80 now, but in 1974, he excommunicated Henry Kissinger from the Jewish religion for his Sabbatean behavior in almost defeating Israel in the Yom Kippur War. He's a great rabbi. And I got very lucky. An Oxford University professor named Avraham Ehrlich also contributed his research to me. And of course, Gershon Scholem. Wherever I could get the truth out, there are brave Jewish writers who got the truth out one way or another, and I used them. And by the way, this also goes for the Holocaust. There were brave Jews who opened their mouths, and they've been rubbed out as effectively as possible from the scene, but they existed. Now, that being said, Frank ran out of money. Jacob Frank ran out of money in the year 1785 or so. In 1786, he moved the whole organization. They were called Frankists. That's what they were called. And some Israelis, Frankisti. Hey, Frankisti. It's still remembered amongst some Israelis the damage these Frankists did to Judaism. Now, here is true blue, the real thing, conspiracy. And conspiracy means a crime between two people. It's not like it's a bad word. It's been turned into a bad word. But this is when the Sabbateans made, well, a pact with the big devils. Suddenly, Jacob Frank got very rich in 1786. He moved his sept to Offenbach, a suburb of Frankfurt. Frankfurt was also the home of Mayor Amschel Rothschild and the home of someone named Adam Weishaupt. Little by little, this, for those unacquainted with this piece of history, the Rothschilds are the Sabbateans of the world. And here is why. There was a meeting that took place apparently in Rothschild's humble home then. In 1786, he was not all that wealthy. He was a coin dealer. His sons made him wealthy. His five sons expanded a business. The business was to control the economies of nations and thus control the nations. He found a magnificent formula. If we can get hold of the nations' economies, we've got the nations. He sat with Jacob Frank, who wanted the Jews to become non-Jews. He wanted them to become Sabbateans. He wanted them to accept the real Messiah of the Jews, Sabbatai Zvi, and incidentally, and the second Messiah, Jacob Frank. That's one of this little three-pointed triangle, that's one point. Adam Weishaupt was the founder of something called the Illuminati. Now, this is a word that in this world of conspiracy has taken immense turns and twists. It was the Vatican. He was a Jesuit trained priest, Adam Weishaupt. He was not Jewish. There are claims that he was not. Their goal, the Illuminati's goal, was to turn back the Protestant Reformation. And believe it or not, the best thing that happened to the Jews was the Protestant Reformation. They didn't believe in inquisitions and crusades. And, yes?
Sorry, we're having informal conversations.
Well, not, well, yes and no, but
could you do a favor, please? Don't speak about the Illuminati. The Illuminati is considered one of these things where the Jews are taking over the world.
Not Jews, it's Catholic. What do you, no, let me go on. I can't change what is
so
the fact.
No. This is not true.
No, I'm not. All right, questions at the end, and that's that. You have to deal with facts, and they're not nice facts. The Illuminati wanted the Catholic Church to be the head of Christendom. They despised Lutheranism. They despised English, the Anglican Church. They wanted to weaken their societies and weaken their nations so that Rome would once again be at the head of international Christendom. That's what the Illuminati was and is. All the rest of the stuff, forget it. Now the point is that in order to bring a new Jew, a Jew that accepts Sabbatai Zvi as the Messiah, in order to get a new Christian who rejects the Anglican Church, who rejects the Lutheran Church, and goes back to Rome, and by the way, the Eastern Church were involved too, anyone who did not accept Rome as the central capital of Christendom was a target. What they did, quite simply, was they had to overturn the existing societies. And unfortunately for us Jews, they did a real job. Now let me tell you that all of this was banned. Now the story in all the history books is the same thing, that there was, just before the French Revolution, a horseman fell. In his satchel were the plans for the revolution. In the satchel were the plans for the Illuminati and so forth. It was all banned. Throughout Europe, it was banned. And that put Weishaupt, that put Rothschild, and to a lesser degree, Frank, into a problem. What do you do if you're banned? And they came up with something that has changed history for good. Weishaupt said, well, what we do is we take our tenants and we put them into an organization that has lodges and chapters worldwide, and we subvert the existing organization to our tenants. And the organization they chose was British Freemasonry. Now, there was no such thing as a Freemasonic conspiracy before the 18th century. As far as I can tell, they were very nice. They were a builder's guild. They backed builders throughout Europe, and they were all right. All of a sudden, there are revolutions. All of a sudden, you have something you never saw before, ever. You actually saw talk of one organization upending whole nations. Now, here's where the Jews fit in, and this is the scary part. You now have a new world. Germany is Sabbataianism. That is where it began. Turkey is the Don. That's the home of Sabbatai Zevi. It's a major player, but it's now being shifted. The real players from here on in were Germany first, and then London, where there was freedom to expand on their ideas. So suddenly you had Jews who were no longer Jews. Karl Marx, Frederick Engels. They moved from Germany to London. From London, their ideas spread all over the world. In America, Solomon Schechter, the Reform Movement, it's all the same. Germany to London, where it spreads to America. All of a sudden, the Jews have gotten enlightenment. Moses Mendelssohn, he wasn't a Jew. He was born a Jew. But he converted, and his children converted, all for the enlightenment of the Jews. One after another, the Jews were being diluted. They were being whittled down. By the way, the situation that I've seen in America is that worked like a charm. I'm telling you, you want to talk about whittled down Jews. This country is really, really, except for the Orthodox, really lost its Jewish thinking and heritage. And that again, Germany, Solomon Schechter, to London. He gets the money, he gets the packing, he goes to America. Now we've got the world's greatest, and this scares Jews, believe me, I'm not blind to this. I'm very aware of this. There's a new history, it's not a new history, it's an old history being retold, but you have to look. And you can't ignore a really serious problem, is that the Rothschilds took on America. And all of the following names are simply not Jewish. Within one generation, they stopped being Jewish. But from Frankfurt, Germany, the Rothschilds sent John Jacob Astor, Jacob Schiff, Max Warburg. He sent all of his agents to America to corrupt the robber barons, essentially. If you were very, very successful, they made a deal with you. You promote our thinking, and our thinking is the end of Jews. It really, really was a war against the Jews in a very different way than people understand. And it becomes harsh from here on in We're now in the 19th century, and that was not a good century for the Jews. That was the century of the pogroms. What you have now with America is, try and find a Jewish Astor anymore. Try and find a Jewish ship. John Jacob Schiff's grandson is married to Al Gore's daughter. This is true blue Sabbataianism. We'll get to that. It's all over the place. It's terrifying, and we'll get to that. They're not Jews anymore, but they are affecting Jews. They want Jews to be something else. Now you've got, I find this a terrifying thing. You've got the Rockefellers, the Morgans, the Carnegies, the Harrimans. They were all given European money. America was not all that rich in the 19th century. You had people building railroads, you had them putting up steel mills, but the money was in Europe. And it was in the hands largely of the Rothschilds. They agreed for ideological purposes that if you play our game, we'll give you power you've never had before. And this is how non-Jews started doing the work of the Sabbataians. And I have to be very, very easy on this. Very easy on this. The fact of the matter is, in the 1870s, the Sabbataians of England decided on something new. The Jews weren't cooperating. They were not changing their point of view. They were not accepting Sabbatai Zvi. They liked their religion. And I got to remind you of something very important. Until the rise of Sabbataianism, secretly, the Jews loved being Jews. It was as natural as breathing. There were no self-hating Jews. After Sabbataianism hit, the Jews started despising themselves. This was also done on purpose. But the point is, in Britain, something called the British Israelites emerged. They actually thought that the British were Israelites. And I've read their stuff, it's weird stuff. In the Roman times, the tribe of Dan landed in England, and London is named from the tribe of Dan, and I've read their stuff. And it's wacky, but nonetheless, they figured out the ultimate plan to get the Jews to be Sabbataians. They're gonna take back Israel. They developed Zionism. In the 1870s, they developed a perfect plan to get the Jews back to where they wanted the Jews to be. They developed Zionism. Keep that in mind. It did not come from the sources we were told they came from. Now, the real problem is the pogrom started in the 1880s. And the idea was to make life so miserable for the Jews of Europe that they would come to Eretz Israel, which was, from 1885 on, the likes of Paris Smoleskine, Nachum Birnbaum, they were the first writers, Zionist writers, but they had no charisma. By the way, all Germany, okay, Vienna, like that's a big difference. The Sabbataians were very influential in the German world, also in Prague, but we'll get to that very, very quickly. The point being is, well, it's a big point. The Jews did escape Europe, but they went to America. That was the problem. 2 million of them escaped Europe due to the pogroms. My grandparents included. But they did not go to Eretz Israel. The first Aliyah was in 1880. A few went to Eretz Israel. The Rothschilds built Rishon LeZion. They built the first city in Israel. They got the ball rolling, but it was a lousy place to go. There was nothing there. There were a bunch of bandits and a bunch of malaria, and it just was not a good place to settle. So now I'm going to jump ahead before jumping back. Eventually, this was solved by someone named Colonel Edward House. He was Woodrow Wilson's, well, he was Woodrow Wilson. What he did is put restrictions on him, grave restrictions on immigration to the United States. and the Jews no longer had that option after 1919, I believe. But let's go to this real problem, and here is Zionism now. Folks, this is going to probably be a little shocking, but Theodor Herzl, I read all the biographies of Herzl, and there's one problem. The Judenstadt was supposedly written in Paris, except it wasn't. He wasn't in Paris when he was supposed to have written the Judenstadt. There is a huge, huge problem there. I read Herzl's writings as a playwright. He was a terrible playwright. And yet the Judenstadt was a brilliant, brilliant book. What you're talking about is that I think it was written for him. But Theodor Herzl had charisma, he was handsome, and he changed Jews. He was remarkable in that respect. And he became the father of modern Zionism. Now, last night I spoke about a meeting, and I'm going to briefly go back to it. In 1898, Theodor Herzl met Kaiser Wilhelm in Jerusalem. Now, if you think that Jerusalem was a good place to go on a holiday in 1898, you don't know how bad it really was. Jerusalem, in fact, was a rotten place. There were no roads. The Kaiser didn't take a tram steamer, everyone else did. You went up skinny little roads, there were no hotels. It was disease-ridden, you couldn't get a decent meal, and yet the most powerful leader of Europe came to Israel to put up three churches, one a very big church, the Church of the Domitian Abbey, the Church of the Domitian. On November 2nd of 1898, in Jerusalem, he met the father of Zionism, Theodor Herzl. Why would Herzl make that awful trip to Jerusalem to meet Kaiser Wilhelm? There was only one answer. He wanted a state. That's the only answer. And if you go on the internet, because this has been the most important meeting of modern Zionism, Herzl meets the Kaiser of Germany in Jerusalem. Try and find it on the internet. It's been rubbed out. And the few sources that I got said all the same thing. Herzl was rebuffed. Rebuffed from what? What did the Kaiser do to rebuff Herzl? And the answer is, he said, no, you're not going to get a state. We are not going to go to war with Turkey and give you a Jewish state, because we have made an alliance with Turkey. And they permitted us to put up a church on the highest point in Jerusalem. I have a picture of it afterwards. Take a look at the Domitian Abbey, and you'll see that Germany and Turkey formed an alliance. And Theodor Herzl changed. Now, I've read about Herzl. He was not a Sabbatean. Herzl was just a charismatic guy who could gather people around him. He was a good guy. In 1901, Theodor Herzl met the British Zionists, who wanted Britain, not Germany, to get the Jewish state. And Theodor Herzl said, forget it. We cannot have a state in the ancient land of Israel. We would have to fight the Turkish German alliance. It would kill millions upon millions of people. We can't do it. It's not worth it. He said to the British, you have land in Africa. Just give us Uganda. It'll do. We'll live with it. And this would have ruined the Sabbatean plan. It would have destroyed the plan of the Sabbateans. The only way to get the Jews to become a different people was to have Eretz Israel back, not Uganda. Uganda wouldn't have done the trick. And anyways, we'd be Rhodesia today, you know? I mean, it wouldn't have worked anyways. So now here, and I warn you ahead of time, it's not easy speech, but nonetheless, I'm going to say it. Theodor Herzl went at the age of 44 into a sanatorium in Paris shortly after this little announcement for a disease. Go and look every which way and find out what was wrong with Harris. Well, I sure couldn't. And he died after 2 weeks in the sanatorium. Now, when I was growing up, this is what they told me. My parents, my Hebrew school teachers, they all told me the same thing. That darn Herzl worked so darn hard that his heart stopped. Yeah, sure he did. He died at 44. Even in 1905, you just didn't drop dead at 44 because your heart stopped. He was murdered. And this was the first of the Zionist murders. And this becomes the worst problem. The worst problem we have is that there were two kinds of Zionisms, and we're going to get to it. The bad kind was labor Zionist. The good kind was revisionist Zionist, of which I was, I still think I'm a proud member of revisionist Zionism. I still think Begin was the best prime minister we had, the only proud Jew, and so forth. This is where I come from, is revisionist Zionism. They tried to sort this awful mess out. And boy, did they pay. We're going to start talking about how they paid. And believe me, it doesn't exist anymore. There's no more Chabrut party. The party of Zev Jabotinsky is dead. It doesn't sit in the Knesset. The Likud was an invention of Ariel Sharon, who was a far leftist who grew up in Kibbutz Kfar Malal, whose best friend was Shimon Peres, and so on and so forth, things you don't have to know. And this, by the way, at the end of this meeting, I'm gonna, in essence, give away my CDs and books. I'm essentially gonna give them away. You take all the CDs for 20 bucks, seven of them, $2 each, $2.50 each. It's a small enough crowd and I don't wanna carry them back, okay? Otherwise, that's it. The book's $5 and stuff, except for Bybek Gaza, which cost me a lot of money. Now, that little plug aside, you've now got a new leader of the Zionists. Now you have to, there was a little gap where someone named Wolfensohn took over the World Zionist Organization, or what became known in Israel as the Jewish Agency. But then you got yourself a bad one. You got yourself a really, really dreadful mass murdering head of the Jewish Agency, Chaim Weizmann. And when you got Weizmann in power, you got the Jews really in a lot of trouble. Now I'm gonna give you one example, and then just to make it easier, and then we'll go backwards. 1936, World Zionist Conference, Basel, Switzerland. Weizmann was applauded, no less, for saying in the upcoming Holocaust, he used the word Holocaust, there may not be 2 million surviving Jews, but they will be strong and good for Eretz Israel. We're going to talk about the connivance very shortly of the labor Zionists with the Nazis. And it's not a nice story. Weizmann knew a Holocaust was coming. It was planned. And we will get to that. And by the way, every word is true. And that's the hard part. And if you think Jews can't be changed, it's a very difficult story, and our lives are on the line right now. In Israel, we've got, what have we got? 80,000 missiles with gas and biological warheads. We're heading for the same Holocaust. It's the same thing is about to happen. If Jews think they know everything, they just are too arrogant to accept a new reality. It's something in the brain of a Jew. I don't know what it is. And if you don't accept this new reality that the leadership of Israel is going to do what the leadership of the Jews did in the 30s and 40s, well, never again is the world's stupidest expression if you don't figure out how they did it last time. You have to figure it out. It doesn't make sense any other way. Israelis wake up in the morning, they can't figure out what their government did. They don't understand why their policemen don't shoot terrorists on bulldozers. They don't understand that since the Oslo Accord, they have been slowly conditioned to give up their state. And here's how they did it last time. And by the way, a third of my family died in the Holocaust. I want you to know that. thanks to my grandfather and me digging through old records and the Yad Vashem and stuff, I found a third of my family were wiped out. So don't think I'm not taking this personally. I'm taking this plenty personally. My children live in Israel. I only left there because I was almost killed there, and it's a different story. Look, in Israel, I was very well known. Let us not fool around with that. I had the number one best-selling book. I was on TV. I couldn't walk down streets in Israel. People would stop me every which way. This wasn't conspiracy talk. Israelis, a lot of them knew I was telling the truth, and most of them were religious. But I was also making headway into the secular crowd, slowly but surely, and that's why they shut me out. Yes, Paris tried to kill Sharon. That's when I started writing about the phony stroke, that he had tea with Paris in the Knesset for a half an hour before he started feeling bad. And then who took him to the hospital but the murderer of Yitzhak Rabin, Yoram Rubin, the bodyguard? It's the same hit squad. And I've been trying to tell them, you got to get these people out of our leadership. You can't have a mafia running Israel anymore. They got to go. This is my core message. These crooks have got to leave. They're ruining us. And they ruined us before. And folks, I'm going to test your maturity now. All right? And I'm not kidding when I say this. You are amongst the privileged who are going to hear this. I give this to Goyish crowds, and they are big crowds, and they accept this. Jews have a different problem. They don't want to accept it. Chaim Weizmann was a butcher. His name should be taken off every university and technical institution, everything. Wipe the name off. What happened now is just dreadful. Now, I'm going to do this. The boring stuff I'm going to get rid of, and we're going to go into the lousy stuff. The boring stuff for the Young Turks. England wanted Jerusalem. Outright, they didn't want to let the Germans have Jerusalem. And in 1908, the Church of the Dormition was built in 1906. In that year, Turkey gave the British the Sinai Peninsula. And if you think the Egyptians were ever the owners of the Sinai Peninsula, it was the Turks who were the owners of the Sinai Peninsula. Egypt had nothing to do with the Sinai Peninsula. And while this exchange was going on, and I pointed out the obvious that in 1906, the Sultan of Turkey tried to keep the British quiet by handing over 36,000 square miles of sand that was never Egyptian. Again, the Jews are stunned. No, the Sinai is Egyptian. I said, there's not one Egyptian living in the Sinai, they're Bedouin. But, you know, you may as well talk to that exit sign. You can't get people to understand the obvious. In 1908, a Sabbatean named Atatürk took over Turkey. And go on the internet and write Atatürk Sabbatean, or Atatürk Jew. And you are going to be very surprised how much Hebrew this man knew. He, the Young Turks, the Donma, took over Turkey through their little Masonic lodges. That's Abraham Erlev. It's in my book, Shabtai's Labor Zionists in the Holocaust. I have all the quotes for you. Turkey was now taken over by the Sabbateans. Stage one done. Stage two, let's practice a Holocaust. They murdered 1.5 million Armenians during World War I. This was a dry run for the big one. And today, by the way, I'm not going to go how the American Jewish leadership made darn sure the Jews of Europe just died, led by Rabbi Stuart Wise. And I have a separate lecture on that mess, that not one Jewish organization, except the Orthodox rabbis, again, except for the Orthodox rabbis, not one Jewish organization tried to stop the Holocaust. Not a one. And that's also in my book, Shabbatai Zevi, Labor Zionism and the Holocaust. Where the hell were the Jews? A third of my family, and I'm sure you have very similar stories. We have now got to this, I'm going to bring us up to date, and up to date, up to date. I'm going to bring you to the year 1932. skipping a lot of stuff. We'll just keep this on topic. In 1932, 250 plus organizations represented German Jewry. 250 plus. In 1934, one, Labor Zionism. All the rest were wiped out, and only one was left, Labor Zionism. Labor Zionism were allowed to keep camps to indoctrinate German Jewry into Sabbataism before they would be shipped to Palestine. Practically all the Jews who came to Israel in the 30s were German. 70,000 of them. Now, here's the reason why. And I'm telling you, folks, we are the core. Either we tell enough people to do something about it, or our present Israel is down the drain. The reason why was the transfer agreement. Go on the, buy my book, it'll be dirt cheap. Otherwise, go on the internet, look up the transfer agreement. What an agreement. And this was the end of Zev Jabotinsky and the Beirut Party as well. The transfer agreement stated, it was an agreement between the Jewish Agency of Jerusalem and the Nazi Party. And it was signed, and it went into effect. The Jewish Agency would allow Germany to make life so miserable for the Jews, that they would come to their indoctrination camps where the weak would be weeded out, eventually to be killed in camps, and the strong would be sent to Israel. In return for which, the Jewish Agency of Jerusalem would make sure that every immigrant used his funds to buy German goods, propping up the economy, would stop all protests, embargoes, anything against the Nazi regime. Worldwide, Jews in America were organizing parades against the Nazis. The word got out from the Zionists in Israel, leave the Nazis alone. The negotiator of the transfer agreement plays a key role because he was Chaim Arlozorov. And this was the murder before Rabin. In case you people didn't know, In Israel, I exposed the Rabin assassination. The book went to number one. Israelis no longer believe that Yigal Amir was the shooter. Israelis now believe Shimon Peres was the organizer. The majority right now of religious is 52%, of seculars 28%, 30%. Chaim Arlozorov was Yitzhak Rabin. He was shot dead on a beach in Tel Aviv, and immediately three Chayrut Jabotinsky followers were arrested and charged with the murder. Of course, they didn't do it. And eventually, they were free. But there was a Zionist conference in Prague in 1933 where the revisionists were fighting tooth and nail to put an end to the transfer agreement. Satan, logically, come in, man. Have a seat. Don't be shy. Just for you, I'll raise my voice. The revisionists were saying, you can't cut a deal with the Nazis. What are you, nuts? There's no such thing that Jews cannot cut a deal with the Nazis. And then a telegram was passed around, and on the podium, everyone gave a look of shock, and they closed the meeting down. Nobody knows what was in the telegram, but the rumor was that Jabotinsky killed Arlozorov. And the next day, the revisionists were thrown out of the Zionist movement. It was over. The labor Zionists now took over Zionism. There was no more revisionists anymore. They were gone until the state was founded. And by the way, we won't do that. The troubles Begin went through to gain legitimacy, but doesn't matter. During the Holocaust, there was only one Jewish organization led by Chaim Weizmann, who knew a Holocaust was coming, planned it with the Germans, and that was Labor Zionism. Now, let me tell you something that's going to be shocking to you. Believe me, I believe that you are mature enough to accept this. It isn't easy for me. Do you think when I was researching this, I was having a good time? I mean, you have to understand, this is crappy work. It's just something that fell into my hands. I wasn't even meant to do this work. You know, I was, until Rabin was murdered, I was the Israeli correspondent for The Hollywood Reporter and for Billboard magazine and Screen International. I was a trade journalist. Who even thought of this stuff? Now, with that in mind, that I was not looking for this, it just came to me, you have to understand, and we're going to talk about perfidy today. It's normally not my speech, but we're going to talk about perfidy today and the killing of 800,000 Hungarian Jews, thoroughly, totally documented. And we're going to do that. We're going to do that soon. The idea of Israel was never to be a shelter for Jews. Never. No religious Jew was allowed in Israel all through the Holocaust. If he got in, it was through his doing. Nobody rescued any religious Jews. The only Jews allowed into Israel from 1933 until the White Paper of 1939 were German Jews. Now, others may have snuck in, but officially, you have to understand the British were working in their way. The Sabbateans were working with the Germans. They cut off the borders of Israel. They trapped the Jews in Europe. It, you know, Israeli, you get this history lesson that the nasty old British blocked our borders. And like it's the most natural thing in the world. This is just something the British would do as the war broke out. Those darn British, they killed 6 million Jews by blocking our borders. Only the revisionists had an idea how bad the... Yes, sir.
Good question. How much of the British not wanting to upset the Arabs was part of this? Very small? Is that, that's what they teach the people in Israel. They teach the children that it was because of the Arabs, the British didn't want to upset the Arabs.
This is a very complicated question. There were British officers who were backing the Sabbateans. And there were British officers who knew what was going on who were not backing the Sabbateans. And this is too complicated to do really quickly. Officially, we'll go into this. Did you know Winston Churchill's mother was a Jew? And that means that Churchill himself was Jenny Jacobson. Her father was a stockbroker from New York. Churchill was a Jew. He was a Sabbatean. Look again. You have to look this up on the internet, who Jenny Jacobson was. Churchill was a Jew. He was another Benjamin Disraeli. It doesn't matter if they convert, the Sabbateans convert and they mix. It's a very ugly, messy situation. Stalin. You think Stalin was a Jew? All three of his wives were Jews. All his children are Jews. This is Sabbateanism. And I don't want to do that horrible, horrible, awful fact that when Hitler invaded Austria, his very first act was to go into the town where he was born and level it, lest his Jewish roots be exposed. This was a Sabbatean war. I'm not being overly dramatic when I say this either. This was a war fought by the Sabbateans, and they are not Jews. Don't mix them up. They are the enemies of the Jews. Don't think it was a Jewish war. It was an anti-Jewish war. Remember this before we go on to the bad stuff. Now we get to the killing. You think in Israel, if the next war is going to be any different than the last war? The last war, you might have seen 60 million dead, but the Jews were the only nation wiped out. You get these anti-Semites saying, yeah, but look at all the Christians that were killed. The Christians survived. The only people who were wiped out because they were of a religion or race were the Jews. That's called a genocide. Stop mixing this stuff up. Now, this is a subject that, again, Israel, you have to understand, Israel was never supposed to be a shelter for the Jews. Israel took the German Jews and used them for seed stock to get a new Judaism. They were going to wipe out the Jews, as many as they could, of Europe and start a new Judaism in Israel based on Sabbataism. You know, again, back to Israelis. Chilonim, lo mevinim, shum klum klum. Everyone thinks it's left-wing, that the problem is the left are crazy. It's not the left. The children of the left maybe never heard of Sabbatai Zvi, but in the ruling quarters, and in Israel that's not very many people, they know darn well who he was. Ben Gurion went to Turkey. He gave up his Russian citizenship. The next president of Israel, Moshe Sharet, joined the Turkish army. The first president of Israel, Ben Zvi, went to Turkey and became a true blue Sabbatean. Israel's founders were Sabbateans who went to Turkey to learn their stuff from the original Sabbateans. This is all true. It's all true. Israel was the worst thing that ever happened to the Jewish people was labor Zionism. It's an utter curse, but not for the reason people think that it's going to hurt Arabs. Forget the Arabs. They're not part of the picture. The war is against the Jews. The Arabs are used. They're savage. They're not so bright. They're used. But the Jews, I want to tell you, I've never met a dumber people in my life because they're going to get another Holocaust. They're going to walk into another one, all by themselves. And they're walking into it every day right now. You know, I went to Israel a long time ago. I spent 32 years there. I served in the army. I believed our Prime Minister Begin was doing right by the Jews. It was a different Israel. My son is now 17 and going in the army. He doesn't want to get in any trouble for Olmert and Paris. You think he wants to defend Olmert and Paris? Everything has gone upside down. Everything. Everything. But let's go back to what they did to us. The British did the white paper routine, and now the Jews of Europe are trapped behind British lines, behind Nazi lines. And a very bad thing started happening. The Nazis were too good at it. Weizmann was not going to get his 2 million Jews. Now, in Marvin Antwon's book, To Eliminate the Opiate, he calls the Holocaust, as the Sabbateans call the Holocaust, he calls it, burning, what does he call it? Burnt offerings. Burnt offerings is the Sabbatean term for the killing of Jews. If you are a Jew who does not believe that Sabbatai Zvi was the Messiah, it is a mitzvah to kill you. They derive energy from this. This isn't properly understood, but it almost came out. Because someone named Malkiel Greenwald, in early 1951 or two, one I think the trial was 52, was sued by the government because he had a little itty bitty broad, it's kind of what I do in a way. I kind of relate to Malkiel Greenwald. He was a hero of the Jews, and he died poor and impoverished and had to go through the legal system, but he got off innocent. He claimed that Rudolf Kastner, a Jewish agency emissary, was working with Adolf Eichmann to destroy the Jews, not save them, to destroy the Jews of Hungary. Now let's put a little perspective into the situation. Hungary was not just Hungarian Jews. Hungary was a refuge for the Jews of Romania, Bulgaria, for the whole region. They chose Hungary because it was the last place they could go. There were 800,000 Jews in Hungary. Rudolf Kastner went to Hungary, supposedly to save them, and Eichmann said, take them all. I don't want them anymore. He knew the war was lost. It was 1944. He said for, I think the figure was 10,000 trucks, non-military trucks. He wanted to take all his loot out of Hungary and he wanted to save his looks. For 10,000 trucks, he would have given up 800,000.